What are you doing there, Deb?
Smelling myself.
But before that, what were you doing?
Well, we decided that the videos were not going viral enough, so we've taken it into our own hands and done tittage. Well, as you know, I just accidentally didn't put a top on.
When you hear the words, you have cancer. It's heartbreaking. But I'm hopefully part of a generation which can live for longer with cancer. But what that looks like, none of us know. Anything can happen. It is a roller coaster, I think. Every single time I'm back on treatment, I'm like, I don't want to be here. Mm. It's just not fair. I have a brain. Just because I have cancer doesn't make me intelligent. It doesn't make me intelligent. Did I just say that?
Over the last 5 years, I've campaigned. I've spoken about awareness. I've shared my story for a reason. The laughs. The giggles. Showing that you can live with cancer. But ultimately, what I really want to happen is I don't want any other Deborahs to go through this.
Just confirm your full name, please, and your birthday.
Yeah, 1st of the 10th, 81, Deborah James.
Yeah.
Hello, I am Deborah, otherwise known as Bowelbabe, and I live with stage 4 bowel cancer. I was diagnosed at the age of 35. So the thing that you need to know about any types of cancer is that you are never too young and you don't really know how to get through each day. You don't really know how you're gonna put one foot in front of the other, and somehow you do.
I was missing my timings of all my medication, so I have to now like lump everything around in a bag. Any cancer patient like just has so many drugs because I have to take them all the time. It's like this relentless everyday routine. My bag is also full of makeup because it hides the fact that I look like I was raging a temperature of 40 degrees like an hour ago.
Can't be many people watching today who haven't experienced cancer in some way.
Well, it's something that Rachel Bland, Deborah James and Lauren Mann have all had to come to terms with after being diagnosed with cancer in their 30s. Together, they've set up a podcast called You, Me and the Big C.
I've got through mine now, the ladies are still in treatment, and basically we really struggled to find people that we could connect with and spoke our language to talk about cancer in a kind of different way.
I'm just going. I have stage 4 cancer and I will just carry on going and living with it. And I think that's what our podcast is about. Yes, I have highs and lows, and excuse me if I start going into a coughing fit, but that's my lung tumours.
Hello and welcome to You, Me and the Big C. Who wants to go first with that tale of woe of being told they had the Big C?
Go on then. So I have the poo cancer.
Which the glam cancer.
I have the glam cancer. There's nothing pink about my cancer, it's just brown. Mm-hmm. So I was diagnosed after 6 months of a change of bowel habits, basically where I was pooing blood. I'm going to be very frank because I think one of the biggest problems is that people are not frank enough about the symptoms that led to their diagnosis. Mm-hmm. And then as a result, it holds up their diagnosis. So I was pooing blood and eventually got diagnosed with a 6.5 centimetre tumour up my bum, basically. And then suddenly the world changes. And
it literally falls out your ass, Deb, doesn't it?
Literally falls out your bum.
Where's out your bum?
For me, it came flowing. So I haven't killed one of them yet. I have 2 children.
Can I crack the eggs?
Yeah, you can crack the eggs. I know I look quite young. Still,
baby face.
Basically, my situation was a big surprise when I got pregnant. At the age of 25.
It's okay, it's good. Hang on.
But essentially, me and my husband, we had kids way earlier than we expected, which was a really great surprise. So it meant that when I was diagnosed with cancer, I had two kids to deal with who were grown up enough to understand what the word cancer means. I'm probably an advocate of being very open with your children, but I have nightmares just reenacting what I had to say to them.
Verdict.
Very good egg.
Very good egg.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I don't even want to think about it. I started my blog as a way of informing people how I was, but I didn't want to write under me. And funny enough, Bowelbabe was available on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. The reason I created her is because I felt that she was the polar opposite to the perception of somebody with bowel cancer.
You've even got your own cartoon graphic.
I've even got a cartoon graphic. Yeah. She's way cooler than me. She's way hotter than me as well. I'm like really jealous of her, wow. I think. I have the old man's cancer, but I like high heels and glitter skirts as well as the next 35-year-old. Yeah. So it's breaking down those perceptions that what of cancer course it looks is. Like as well. But yeah, it started for me, and then it led to a point where obviously now I write a column.
So in this week's column, I've written some top tips to help if you have a friend or relative who might be going through cancer. Really importantly, don't say to somebody, you can beat this. Stay positive, you will win. Research has proven that putting that kind of pressure on cancer patients actually just makes them feel like rubbish. And you know what? Cancer is a beast.
I've got to like plough on with loads of emails.
Put out a couple of ads. Write a column. Actually, like, work.
I've been writing it for 5 years now. I actually love the sun. I grew up with a deaf nan who used to buy the sun every day and then collect all the coupons, you know, all the ones for, like, oh, look, you could get a caravan holiday for 10 quid. Like, if she was alive, she would be, like, so proud. She would be the kind of person who would be like, oh, look, that's my granddaughter's arse in the sun. But, yeah, I actually really enjoy writing for the sun because, for me, if you're going to talk about bowel cancer, you want to do it on a really big platform. So that's, like, always a weekly commitment. And then commercially, I work with brands. And actually, I really enjoy that because it's a bit of escapism. I don't know what there is to see. A lot of people don't understand, like, why would you work if you've got stage 4 cancer? But it's like, well, I like fashion.
So the 18-year-old version of myself would wear this without the hand in front because, well, gravity.
You need to do something, and I don't just want to do cancer all the time.
In fact, the 38-year-old version of myself with a couple of glasses of wine for Christmas time probably would wear it anyway.
I do enjoy it, and then I look at it as my work because it is how I earn money, which doesn't always sit well with people because a lot of people would be like, oh, you know, you've got a husband who can afford to do stuff, why don't you just, like, do that? And I'm like, I've got my life, albeit at the moment it's very much hospital-focused.
How
about
the weekend?
Yeah, it's quite crap because I just was spiking these fevers.
In terms of treatment, I have had a bowel resection. Your bowel is like a drain pipe and they've chopped a bit out and stuck it back together, which is fine. It does mean that things go through it very quickly now. Then what happened is my cancer travelled quite quickly to my lungs. They basically had to slice open my ribs and cut out little wedges of my lungs where the tumours were.
Knackered.
My statistics are hideous. Less than 1 in 10 people survive what I have for more than 5 years. So I know what I'm faced against, but I have hope. But to be honest with you, I feel that if you don't have hope, then what have you got? Don't get me wrong, we all agree that the physical challenge is there, but the mental challenge, that's just as much in itself.
Before I got cancer, I didn't even know what chemotherapy looked like, what it involved. I had absolutely no idea how you even got it into your body. And there are lots of different ways. I'm on a regime where I have chemotherapy given to me via a port. And my port is actually inside my body and it's connected to one of my main veins. Now, there are loads of myths around chemotherapy. The first one is, Deborah, you still have hair. Now, It depends on the type of chemotherapy, but I do have other side effects. In fact, on my chemo regime, I've lost the feeling in my hands and my feet. And quite frankly, it sucks.
The first time I did react, I had the crush team. And I was kind of like, okay, so we just try something else. And it's like, no, we just pump you full of Piriton and we carry on.
Take a break and carry on.
Take it. Because there is an alternative.
You've got to have it, haven't you?
You've got to have it.
So I'm here at the Marsden having cycle 19 at the moment. I'm on that drug that makes me, like, slur and lose my ability to sound sober. I have Nikki with me again, and we were drinking last night, and we've decided I'm doing an experiment. This is totally on PC, so don't shout at me. But I'm normally given a drug. Here's how I get really, really anxious. However, last cycle, my sister brought in some Prosecco and I realised it does the same job. So we're just... Cheers. I'm videoing instead of taking a picture. Drunk.
You're not allowed to drink alcohol whilst you're having chemo.
Yeah.
But let's face it, there are some really rubbish times. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've had moments where you are pooing out of your bum whilst throwing up, whilst wetting yourself. Physically, you're thinking, I'm only just scraping by. And then mentally, you're like, I've had enough. Like, how can I carry on doing this? And somehow you find the strength to do it. I have to have words with myself. I would say do whatever you need to do to get through it. So I've done dancing during chemo, fancy dress during chemo, my mates during chemo, on my own during chemo. I juggle, I do spinning plates.
It's like that distraction, isn't it?
It's total distraction. Whatever it takes, do it. And then I have to say, I was surprised by how flawed I actually got. You know, I'm fit, young, healthy. Apart from the stage four cancer. We'll just ignore this. But I was surprised at how many days I spent horizontal. And nobody ever tells you that they give you steroids to counteract the side effects of chemo. And it means that you can't sleep. Every single cycle, at 3 o'clock in the morning, I'm doing the Macarena around my sitting room. The funny thing is that I'm posting it at 3 a.m. and I'm getting like 50 responses going, me too.
Okay. Everybody comfortable?
I'm going to say, Deb, you look like shit.
I think you should say that.
Yeah, definitely.
Hello, ladies.
Hiya. Well, Deb, you look like shit.
Why, thank you. Yeah, I've made my best poo effort today.
Deb is sat next to me in a poo costume.
I'm dressed as a poo costume. As a poo costume, I'm dressed up in a poo costume because it is Bowel Cancer Awareness Month. However, I didn't realise that it was meant for a six-year-old, but I am still wearing it.
You fit into it, girl.
It looks good on you, Deb.
I wore it on the train on the way up here.
What was the reaction to that?
Lauren disowned me.
I just looked away for a brief moment continually the whole journey.
With the poo. I'm like, let's talk about poo, baby. Let's talk about you and me. Let's talk about all your good chits and your bad chits.
But that's the important thing about Bowel Cancer Awareness Month, isn't it? It's talking about your poo.
I'm too sexy for my love. Too sexy for my love. Love's going to leave.
I'm just going to kind of be a bit of a data geek. So for girls in the UK, 1 in 19 of us will get bowel cancer. So it's now the fourth biggest cancer. However, it's the second biggest killer behind lung cancer. And the reason for that is because of a late diagnosis in people. So I think the reason I'm dressed as a poo is just to make you check your poo.
Have a little nose, and if there's any, what are the symptoms?
So yeah, the symptoms of bowel cancer are basically blood in your stools, a bit of weight loss, change in bowel habits. They're the kind of key things to look for.
I was training to be a head teacher, and I was on a fast track scheme.
I was a deputy head teacher in a secondary school until a year ago, and I absolutely loved it. So when I'm invited to speak at events, I love that because I kind of still feel like I'm teaching, but I have a new purpose in a way. And I feel like I'm actually making a difference.
This is lovely Rosa. I've been diagnosed at 23 with stage 3 ovarian cancer.
You guys have literally been step by step with me on this mad journey since.
I was going to say, you are dancing on the train.
Seeing you guys able to get the train to Manchester, live your lives, wear lipstick and socialise and dance makes me so excited for when I can get my life back on track. Sending you big love from hospital. So Rosa, sending you big love from the Yumi Big C studios, because this is what, for us, this podcast is about. Yeah. And I'm just so glad you don't feel alone.
I'm not going to look at you. I'm going to fall. A crying poo is not what we need right now.
I am notorious for being the world's worst baker.
I've always been quite lazy, have hated housework, can't cook, and have a real temper on me. But now I have a really good excuse for all of those.
Yeah.
I can get away with everything now.
Yeah.
But in terms of the positives, I think it gives you a real perspective on what matters in life, what your priorities are. And yeah, apologies if I don't have any sympathy for you if you've got a cold anymore.
Yeah.
Yes, off.
Okay.
Okay.
5, 6. Okay, ready, go.
I was very career-driven, workaholic.
You just come mucked it up.
Right.
Yeah, you did. Yeah, you did.
Would leave my house at 6:30 in the morning, come back at 7:30 at night. I was never there at any sports days, plays, whatever it was.
Okay, you ready?
I had my priorities wrong, but I didn't know it at the time.
Ready?
But suddenly I was forced to give that up, and I actually had to learn to become a mum.
Yes! Okay, again.
I never did the whole mum thing.
Yes! Well done.
And actually, it's been brilliant.
Okay. Wait, let's see.
I'm not a natural earth mother. I might do it with a glass of wine, but I've now got a much better relationship with my kids as a result of my cancer.
Okay, that was cool. I'm happy with that.
Yeah.
High five.
I think it changes you. I wish something else had changed me. And there's aspects that they think mummy having cancer is brilliant.
It's actually good.
And they then will be very blunt. And we'd be like, yeah, well, before you got cancer, we never really saw you.
Yeah.
And I'm like, seriously, did it take cancer for this?
So I've just been told that I'm in remission. I am happy right now. I have just spent the last 40 minutes sobbing in with my oncologist.
Remission's a really big word, isn't it? And the problem is with me is that it's probably going to come back. But fuck it, I'll take it. So now I don't really know what to do with myself. I think I need to probably wipe my tears. Tell some people.
It's my turn now, so let's just hope my shorts stay up.
Hey!
Hey, Dad, in he comes. This is Alistair, Deb's dad.
Zip up!
So I had some really good news this morning, but I've lied to Mum.
Deborah. not the first time in my life.
Not the first time in my life. So I got told this morning that as of today I'm cancer-free. Whoa! Now, it doesn't mean, and you know this, that it's going to last, but I think it's something to celebrate.
So why haven't you bought a bottle of wine with you in the room?
Oh, my God!
So my dad's been carrying my bag.
He knows you well, doesn't he?
And he knows it's been really heavy, and he's like, what have you got in your bag? I've got champagne in my bag. We all know the reality that we can be up one moment, down the next.
Yeah.
Stop pissing on your own parade. You're not jinxing it by enjoying it.
Did your mum work?
Here we are.
Yeah, she still works now. My mum is mid-60s. She still teaches gymnastics and circus skills, so my love of the circus comes from my mum. And I get that kind of love of fun from my parents, but also that attitude of, well, just get up and carry on.
From Woking, Debbie James.
I was actually a national gymnast.
I was very bendy. I am not bendy anymore, for anyone listening.
I used to train 30 hours a week in the gym when I was growing up. It gave me, like, massive resilience. You know, there was this real mental toughness. You never end on a fall, but you got back up and you carried on. That was my childhood.
my family mean the world to me. That is how I function, because of my family, basically.
This is March 1989 with our new video camera.
That I kind of am really busy until I'm really ill, and then I suddenly turn up with my bags packed on the doorstep. I kind of keep on calling it hotel parents.
So our favourite game to play is how drunk are you on the breathalyzer test? Dad, what do you reckon you'll be?
High.
But underneath it, I don't really know what they actually feel. You know, my parents might say, everything's fine, you know, we're here. Or my brother will be like, oh, yeah, everything's fine, I'm just going to go and run the marathon for you. Or my sister will turn up at the hospital and sleep over, even though she's got her own kids to look after. And they will only ever tell you sometimes what they think you want to hear, because they don't want to add to what I'm already emotionally going through.
As parents, you're there at the back. So it was a bit like when she was at university. We didn't hear from her when life was good. If she was ill, Mum got a phone call. Dad got the phone call, I sort of need money, or my car's broken down. And it's a little bit the same. If his life's going well and she's doing okay and we're seeing on the Instagram all the tweets, whatever, that's great. And then we see the, I've had enough. Back to the little kid throwing up. And when it's your child, all you want to do is put an arm around him and take it away. And you can't do that. And that's tough.
Is very much part of my life, but I don't want it to define me. I want to look in the mirror and I want to see the old me. I want to see somebody that was interested in clothes and makeup, and I still am interested in clothes and makeup and wine and and the mask that makeup can give you very much hides the insecurity, the scared, the feeling of uncertainty that lies very much behind that mask.
I was determined that I didn't want to look ill at all costs. So I like upped my lipstick game, I upped my nail game. Like, even my husband was like, Deborah, you take better care of yourself now that you have cancer than you ever did. And actually, it becomes like a self-fulfilling thing. So if I look in the mirror and I look like crap, I feel like crap. Then if I kind of suddenly put a face on, I suddenly feel a little bit better. And I think it's part of my coping strategy. But I've always been kind of a person that likes to look sexy. And one of the things that affected me most was the scars that I got because of the operations that I've had.
Talk us through your scars. What have you got?
Well, I can show you my scars.
Oh, girl!
I have a big scar running all the way down my stomach. I've got a big scar that runs across my back.
Those were difficult to deal with to start.
Yeah, really. Actually, I was part of a project called Behind the Scars. It's with a brilliant photographer, Sophie Mayan. She has a pledge that everything is as it is, but she somehow makes people look really beautiful. And I, for the first time, saw myself actually looking okay again.
Yeah.
And then suddenly that gave me more confidence. I've done them naked with a chemo pump attached to me now. It's something to finally feel quite proud of. And I got to the point where my daughter's been coming along to the shoots. Although, funny enough, I got criticised of sexualising cancer and it being a party. And that I didn't actually understand what cancer was really like because I hadn't lost my hair. And I was thinking, you know, the one thing that we can do as a cancer community is not play a game of my cancer's worse than yours.
The cancer top trumps.
The cancer top trumps. My cancer is my cancer. Yeah. Your cancer is your cancer. And we deal with it in the way that we best know how to deal with it. And if that's slightly quirky, that's slightly quirky, but that gets me up in the morning. And if you want to be miserable, be miserable. You know, we celebrated me getting into remission.
Yeah.
So I'm not really in remission anymore.
How long did we get?
We got 3 months. Yeah. And to be fair, you know, I was like living it up. And I had a scan, which was a monitoring scan. And then I got, like, the arm on the shoulder thing. Bloody cancer has decided to go and put itself in the most awkward of spots. So I've now got a spot that is basically wrapped around a bloody artery, which means that it's inoperable and incurable. And I just shut down all my doors and I went on a bender for about a week.
I appreciate that's not what you should do, but I'm like, how do you process the fact that it's just about extending my life? That could be for years and years and years, but it's not great. Can I just say, I'm not an alcoholic, and I know I refer to wine quite a lot. I do know the limit sometimes.
And sometimes, but you need a bit to numb a bit. And whether that's, whether it's a Valium or a glass of wine.
You need to live, you need to enjoy yourself. If you want a glass of wine, have a glass of wine. Life is so short.
How are you, Rach?
Well, up and down, mostly down. I was out on a Friday afternoon with Freddie, and this phone call came, and he said, I'm really sorry, it's the cancer, it's back, and it's all in the skin around the chest. I just couldn't believe it, and little Freddie was just playing innocently away, so just like dashed home as quickly as I could, and just all the way home was just saying to Freddie, I'm so sorry.
Because you're going to make me...
Sorry, it's the first thing that's made me cry in the whole 12 episodes of our podcast. It's finally broken me.
You've not done anything wrong. You've not done it, so you have nothing to apologise for.
No, but I just find it really difficult for... See, once you switch on the tears, then you're not going to switch them off again. We've got to have some pictures taken later as well, and now I'm just looking at the screen. Oh, dear. I mean, it's not a good picture.
I'm not quite in the headspace to have a conversation about death. Mm. So even knowing that we were talking about it, for the last week, every time I go to sleep, I have been wondering whether just going to sleep is like dying. Yeah. I mean, I'm sweating. Yeah. I'm sweating like a pig over here just talking about it.
I am not scared of actually dying. It's just the leaving people behind. Mm-hmm.
Rach died, and I am going to use that word because that's what she wanted us to say. She died yesterday, leaving behind loads of friends and family, and obviously her beloved Steve and Freddie.
I woke up this morning and felt so proud, actually, of our girl. I felt so proud to be part of her life, and it's tragic and it's awful. But at the same time, we can take a lot of comfort from the way that she lived. And that's what I love about Rach, and it's what she taught us about kind of living while she was dying, is actually by lifting that veil, we can kind of show people that you can live with cancer, as awful as it is. Mm-hmm. She sent us death jokes in her final messages.
There were gifts, Grim Reaper gifts, weren't there, at one point?
When we found out that my cancer had returned, we had bumping kind of gifts. And at that point, we both had a bit of a cry, and then she turned around, she said, Deborah, we need to wipe our tears, and we need to just get on with living.
We welcome Rachel's husband, Steve. He's with us in the studio today. Yay. Only one person would have in that chair.
Oh, thank you very much. I feel very honoured.
How are you, Steve?
I'm okay. I mean, it's been more than a couple of months now.
2 months. 2 months, 2 days.
And trying to be as positive as I can on the good days, and then recognise the bad ones and have a little cry then. How are you two, though? That's what the listeners want to know.
There's loads to go through. I mean, I probably have always been an exhibitionist, but I've done things that I never thought I could do, and it is because of cancer. Yeah. I'm dyslexic, and I've just written a book. I'm not saying dyslexia stops you, but I never thought I was a writer.
Well, this one's book launch.
It's so funny, isn't it, when you suddenly have something to write about. You
find your voice.
You find your voice.
I enjoyed seeing that before.
And it's amazing, the opportunities. I'm petrified of flying, but I actually flew a plane myself. Lauren, it's your phrase, isn't it? And I know that there's going to be a beep coming up. It's rather than a bucket list, it's a list. But I really like that attitude. You leave the obsession at the door, and then you realise that life can go on. And 10 days after treatment, I decided to run a half marathon, but a 15K. I now know I basically did a stress fracture on my ankle and carried on running.
Of course you did.
I had to use my crutches.
To go on stage and get an award, because we won an ARIA. Can we do a round of applause, please? Yay!
You, Me and the Big C is a gold ARIA-winning podcast.
Cancer's given me a confidence in my own ability and my own self-worth in a way. I can see the impact that sharing and talking about our cancer is doing. People who don't have cancer wanting to listen to what life with cancer is like, and I think that's brilliant.
Okay, say hi. Smile.
What are we actually doing?
I don't know.
No, sure.
We're just like on the red carpet, getting a bit like nervous. Some fury.
About 3 days before a Sports Personality of the Year.
I cannot believe how close we are to the front.
I got approved to start a triplet of new drugs. They have developed what will be one of the first non-chemo treatments for this type of bowel cancer. I'm now leading the path for others.
Oh my God.
I feel really honoured to do that, but I'm shit scared as well, because when a reaction happens...
Yeah, the doctors that I'm looking at and go, oh, when this happened last time, we did this.
The next morning, I woke up feeling really rough, and I ended up for the next 2 weeks in and out of hospital.
On that night, you sort of showed us on your chest.
Yeah.
You're not too far down on the chest, but just top of the chest.
The upper chest region.
The upper chest region. You showed us... You know,
it
like
kind of bubbling away,
like the starting of a little rash, didn't
you? Yeah. Basically, it transpired I'd had a really bad allergic reaction to the drugs. My skin became septic, and I had fevers. Unfortunately, sometimes your body just can't take the treatment. Mm. And I even wrote myself a letter that said the things I need to do before I die. Because I actually thought that this was the kind of start of the end for me. So I've had 5 weeks off treatment, and it's only now that my team have gone, yeah, Deborah, that's the worst rash we've ever seen. But the good news is that despite the fact that I only had 12 days of this new treatment, my tumours have temporarily stopped growing. It shows that it's the right drug. So right now, 3 days ago, I started back on the same drugs, but at a severely lowered dose with lots of drugs to take alongside them to try and tolerate it. The way that I look at it is that I have hope in science. If I can kick my can another 3 years down the road, maybe there will be something that will come in that will then give me another 3 years, which then might give me another 3 years. So I'm not unrealistic, but that's how I deal with it. I'm a Christmas sucker. I love Christmas. I love the glam and the glitter and the sparkles, and I believe in Santa Claus. Do you believe in Santa Claus?
My three-year-old son is listening. Then yes, absolutely.
I like sitting on his knee. No, I'm joking. Oh, here we go.
Oh, my word.
No, sorry. Anyway, Santa always comes at Christmas time. It's quite funny because I love the lead up. I love all the like Christmas lights and I love Christmas shopping. And then I'm always a bit of a Debbie Downer on Christmas Day. You have to battle with yourself over the thoughts of, is this my last Christmas?
Yeah.
Because then you get emotional and you think, is that the last time that I'm going to like wrap presents for my kids? Is that the last time that I'm going to do the whole Santa thing? But it is tough. For me, it's always a time of reflection in terms of saying, actually, I'm pretty grateful for just being alive. Okay, I still have more chance of dying this new year than surviving, but I got through the flu and I'm still here. I was on a really interesting debate with an oncologist. I thought he'd be saying, don't smoke, don't drink, don't do this, don't do this. And he didn't say that. I ended up really agreeing with him in that you can do all these things and exercise and eat well. But I'm the vegetarian of 25 years that was fit and healthy that got bowel cancer. So it's not going to stop you.
Such a cool place to run.
Whilst we can't necessarily cancer-proof our life, we can all do things to ensure that we give ourselves the best possible chance. And I think one of the reasons I got through so many cycles of chemo is because I was quite active. But I run to prove that I'm not dying yet. I am not fast. I am very, very, very slow. And I mean that. But I ran to the Marsden to get an operation. Mentally, for me, if I can do that, I am not dying.
Right, okay, guys. Lauren, you can be some love. We go a bit closer if you
want. Wagwan, my name is Lauren and I'm recording a podcast. Right,
that's when I need to put it down.
Can I just say, firstly, thank you so much for being here with me because I think it gives me a good distraction. Mm.
What's she like as a patient, Dr. Fatiadis?
Well, she's amazing, especially when she's asleep. You know, she's very positive and I like that, you know, and I like all the things that she's doing for our patients. She's amazing, to tell you the truth.
Cheeky.
I'm having a technique called ablation. I'm sure it's incredibly technical, but essentially somebody's sticking a hot poker in you and burning the tumours out. I might sound really cheery right now, but I am incredibly nervous. I'm just scared. I'm just really, you know what it is? I'm really scared of not waking up.
Bye, babe. Good luck.
Bye. Hello. Here she is.
We're going to take a decision.
Can we just say that my husband is here? He's not going to speak.
He's not going to speak.
Yeah. You're going to at least say hello.
Say hello.
Is that it? Is that your podcast debut?
You look pretty tired.
Yeah, we're going to love you and leave you, Deborah, so you can get some shut eye. You can get back to being fabulous once you've had a sleep, okay?
Your lipstick, yeah. Which is like,
the first thing. Really? Is it?
That is the only
thing. In every operation you come out, that's the first thing you've asked for. Cool. Yeah. You haven't asked for that yet.
It's the big night in today, isn't it? And there's the big bike in.
Yeah, we're actually doing it as a family already. So we decided to kind of cut up the 100 miles between us. My husband is currently next to me, drenched in sweat at moments. I can show you.
Oh, that's cool. Show us. He won't mind, I'm sure.
He won't mind.
The thing that I forget sometimes, because my husband said this before to me, is I forget that there's two people going through this, or there's more than two people.
Yeah.
But, you know, one moment I'm vomiting and crying in pain or complaining in the dark depths of, like, oh, I hate cancer. And then the next minute I want to be seen as, like, oh, do you want to have sex with me? Right, I want to, like, you know, you must desire me or whatever. Yeah, yeah. Like, to be able to flip in all those different situations is a total head screw. And I think we muddle on through, and I do love my husband very much. Naturally, you're just thinking, I really hope we can grow old together.
Okay. Oh, no, it's all right. It's not... Oh, yeah, no, it is branding. Shit.
Yeah, he's probably done to it.
Mate, I look rough. The hat's just...
Deb, you don't look rough. You look beautiful.
This is real life cancer. Sometimes people say to me, why do you put stuff on social media? Why do you do loads of videoing and photographs?
We're here in Richmond Park. I've got the kids. They're going into school afterwards.
That is my memory making. Everything that I do, the experiences that we have together, for me, are about making memories today that will last a lifetime. That's my way of dealing with it. So they can look back at my Instagram and go, oh yeah, look, that's mummy speaking. Oh yeah, look, that's her podcasts. And for me, I take quite a lot of comfort in that, actually.
Oh, I remember that. That was a dark thing, right?
So we've just recorded Q&A podcast. Very fun, isn't it?
I vomited in
She
the
had to leave the booth because she vomited in the middle. We're getting her home to bed now, aren't we? Bless her.
I have just finished a course of cyberknife treatment. Cyberknife is basically really, really targeted radiotherapy. Mine was equivalent to 37 days of radiotherapy at an even higher dose because it's in a smaller area, so they can use the machine to target it to 0.1 of a millimeter, which is mad. Unfortunately with me, because they did it in my liver is now really inflamed and it's making me dog sick to the point that I have basically been vomiting on and off for the last 10 days, and I've never known fatigue like it.
Customer information. All TfL services are now solely focused on ensuring critical workers can move around as needed. You should not be using public transport or travelling for anything other than essential journeys.
I'm not going to say it's been plain sailing for me, but lockdown almost suits me quite well. I needed an excuse to slow down. And actually, I was really lucky that my treatment continued.
Good morning, Deborah.
But going through cancer treatment this year has been really, really tough. I have this feeling of wanting to escape in old world. I will literally go, I'm jumping on a plane for the weekend. And yeah, I have the luxury to do that, but it's an escape. It is literally like, I can't leave my cancer behind, so I'm going to try to remove myself from the equation. And I would say not having those coping mechanisms is really, really challenging. I have to be grateful for a team that went, we can carry on. But the thing that's really scary for me is the number of machines that have just been lying dormant across the country. It's going to cost lives. It's going to cost thousands and thousands of lives.
Pressing record. We are in business.
I'm recording. Yeah. Sorry, my door's just gone off. I love that. Real life, recording at home in COVID, and the delivery arrives.
Let's do it.
Boom.
Now, we're going to speak to Kelly Smith, otherwise known as Kick-Ass Gal. So, Kel, tell us about your story. Where did it all start? Like, tell us about your lovely son.
Yeah, Finley, he's 6 years old. You look at something and you think, how have I done that? He's so amazing. But diagnosed 3 years ago with stage 4 bowel cancer. So went on to have the liver resection. And I think that's when I came on with you guys.
So we're in the studio recording. There's the girls. And we've got a very special guest in. It's bloody Kick-Ass Kel. Woo!
I have a message from you the day after you were diagnosed. And you said, I've just been diagnosed with stage 4 bowel cancer. It's okay, I found you. We're going to do this. And you've been coming to the hospital to visit me.
Yeah, so you guys were like the first people that I'd met that were my age that were living with cancer.
So kind of fast forward to a few months ago.
I got a text message from you. It says my chemo's been paused for 12 weeks and I'm fuming about it.
That's the day lockdown was announced, wasn't it?
Yeah, treatment was stopped. And since the treatment has stopped, everything was just growing out of control. And that's when they said that there's nothing else that we can do now.
Kel, how do you actually feel, like, honestly?
Absolutely terrified. I don't want to die. Like, I feel like I've got so much more to do.
So I just got off the phone to Kelly for what I think will be the last time. I did what I normally do in these situations, which is basically put my running shoes on and then I come down to the river. And I'm now waiting for my friend to die. I know it might seem weird jumping on camera after hearing that your friend has died, but I don't want her story to be in vain, actually. I hate cancer. I hate COVID. And I think that we can do better. We're not at the point in science where we can cure everything, but time, we want more time. Thank you so much. Oh my God, only Kelly would have a pink, sparkly coffin. Like, that actually brings such a massive smile to my face. Just before Kelly died, I said to her thank you for
sharing your story. And she said, do you think it will make a difference? And I kind of laughed at her and I said, of course it will. But now I feel this, I really hope it does make a difference. I told you I wasn't gonna cry. Oh, Kelly, don't make me cry.
It's a big, big wake-up call that not all of us will survive cancer. And all these people that I kept on thinking would be lucky, I'm sitting here thinking, why on earth am I alive? I just feel like a ticking time bomb. And I'm just thinking, when?
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas.
I am an example of science, and we know that it doesn't mean I'm going to be cured or live forever. But I feel like I'm flying on the wings of science, and those wings of science keep me alive. I am on drugs that weren't developed when I was diagnosed, and the best Christmas present I had was that those drugs were approved on the NHS for thousands of people. 4 years ago, I was told I wouldn't make my 40th birthday, and I certainly wouldn't make 5 years. If I believe that, then I'm in the last year of my life. And I can't tell you whether I'm going to make my 40th birthday, but I really damn well hope I'm going to.
But this year, I got a doctorate, which I think is brilliant.
My previous topic was computer science, so obviously now talking quite a lot about poo and bowel cancer is quite far removed from computer science. But it still has a purpose, and the purpose is to engage, to inspire.
As long as I have a purpose in whatever I do, as cheesy as that sounds, appreciating that purpose helps you through.
I've made it to the milestone. I'm in my chair. Step one has already happened, which is poor access. 2.5 years ago, I was given this lifeline of targeted therapy, and it put my cancer to sleep. But what people don't get about it is that, on average, people get about 6 months extra life, and I got 2.5 years. I knew the drugs were stopping working. Everyone's like, oh no, that's a disaster. I'm like, it's not. My story's a really positive story because I've done so much living in that 2.5 years. It's quite phenomenal. But basically, everything went tits up. My liver started failing. I was peeing Coca-Cola coloured urine. I couldn't think. Everything was so foggy. And it's because my body was being flooded with toxins that it couldn't remove. My cancer was essentially just squeezing my bile duct. Like, suddenly death isn't one step away, it's the next step away. But later that day, as soon as the bile duct stent had been put in, my pee totally changed colour, and I cried looking at my pee because I knew that that was a sign that it's flushing it through. But my team made it very, very clear that the aim of the game is to get you back on chemo because my cancer is growing and it has to work.
I think it's very safe to say you're also back on the steroids.
I'm literally.
You can tell a mile off when Deborah James is on the steroids. What doesn't kill you makes you stronger. Stand a little
taller. Doesn't mean I'm lonely when I'm alone. I don't think I have ever been so grateful to sit in a chemo chair and be able to get drugs that might give me a chance, because it is my only chance right now. Seb sat the kids down and kind of just said to them, you know, mummy's really ill at the moment. And Eloise kind of said, okay, she'll get to chemo and we'll be okay. And actually, I never wanted my kids to be scared of seeing me attached to the pump. And so we always used to do this thing called chemo dancing. I would come home high as a kite on steroids and we would just dance. And as soon as they said that, I was back on chemo. Eloise said, great, we can do the chemo dances again. And then my daughter was away camping at the weekend, so Hugo was like, oh no, does that mean I've got to do it? He allowed me to upload it, and I had to just tell him it's starting to go a little bit viral. It's already done 500,000 views. The last time I did it, he was half his height. And I was like, this is what research,
what medicine has given me. It's given me the opportunity to see my son become taller than me. And I think that's incredible.
I can't think about the future. Sometimes in the moments of darkness, actually, I can only think about the next hour. It's kind of, how am I going to get through an hour? And if somebody says to me, you know, I just can't cope with it, I kind of say, well, break your day down so much that you put things on your list, like get up and get dressed, because then you are already winning. If you achieve that and that's all you achieve in the day, well done. Because sometimes we have such rough days that actually we have to celebrate if we've just made it through the day. 50% of the battle is the mental battle.
I can't go out. I'm sick.
It's 2-hour windows where you feel well enough to make the most of that opportunity. I don't have the luxury of kind of saying, oh, well, it might come around again. I don't think any of us do, actually. And so you kind of have to grab it. What people don't see behind the scenes is it might take 2 days sleep in order to have that 2-hour window.
But I just want to live and make the most of every single tiny second. My mum has just walked into the room.
Hello.
Hi, Heather.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm fine, actually.
But it's been, I imagine, you know, a really tough couple of weeks.
Yeah. I suppose you just get on and do it. You have your dark moments, and I do have sleepless nights, and then your brain takes over. And then you think, no, what would be, and you can just make the best of what you've got.
I'm maybe nearly 40 this year, but my mum has been sleeping on the sofa because I've been at hers for this chemo cycle. Because I said, I do not want to be alone. And my mum was just there, like up all night, lying next to me.
Do you know, Alistair and I, we sort of look and said, this is serious. And we just get on with it. And she tries to protect us.
I think if you admit it to your parents, you know how serious it is. You know, it must be heartbreaking for her to watch me having to flush myself. But then I don't want everybody to sit around crying, thinking this is the end, if there's still a little bit of hope. I talk about being in the trenches, but when you're in the trenches and you've got somebody holding your hand, you can walk through it together.
Hello, I'm Deborah.
Hello, I'm Emma.
And today, we're coming for you.
Coming for you
live from the chemo ward at the Royal Marsden, where I'm hooked up to my chemo pump and I'm hooked up to my chemo pump. My bad habits lead to late nights
and in alone conversations with a stranger I barely know. Emma Campbell is my lovely friend, and we have run a marathon together, haven't we, Emma?
We certainly have, one of the major life moments, I think. Do my bad habits lead
to you? Heading to the Marsden steps right now. Finished in about 2 or 3 minutes.
Can you believe it?
Over the past few weeks, I've been facing up to my cancer, being on the march, and I, well, for want of a better word, I have been at rock bottom. I'm back on chemo, and I don't think I've ever felt so destroyed in terms of side effects in my entire life, to the point that 2 days ago, I thought maybe I should just stop, have one last holiday, hope to see my kids to secondary school and then die. I've always thought, I'm going to live, I'm going to live, I'm going to live. And for the first time, the voice in my head is saying, you're going to die, you're going to die, you're going to die. I just need that voice to shut up, because that voice is doing my head in. But how do you pull yourself up?
So I had a lot of regular therapy, but I can honestly say it just didn't touch the level of fear and catastrophic thinking that I was permanently in. I had to get to a certain point myself. A shift for me that's helped me so enormously is bringing myself back to the now as much as possible. Now. Right now, this minute, I'm drinking that cup of tea or I'm eating that custard cream. That was my step one towards finding some kind of coping, because I know that that tsunami is going to hit us again. So any moment of peace, any moment where the mental agony is subsided, that's what I just have to hold on to.
Because actually, it's all we've got is today, right? Head up,
friend of mine who sadly isn't here, he made me appreciate the rain. He was dying not from cancer, from cystic fibrosis. And I saw him the week before he died. And he was like, Deborah, I want to feel the rain on my face for the last time. And so I took him out and we wheeled him around the hospital. And he said, it's amazing. And now every single time it rains, all I can think about is the fact that actually for some people, it's the last time that they will ever feel rain on their face. So when my body is strong enough, the thing that I love to do the most is to go and run in the rain, because it reminds me of all the people who actually would give anything to feel the rain on their face. Let us hold each other. It's those tiny things that makes me feel really, really privileged in quite dark situations. It's just relentless, but I have just done this campaign with Lorraine about raising awareness for bowel cancer.
Tell me exactly what it's all about, what we're going to be doing.
So it's all about getting bums on seats.
Right.
Getting bums on seats to smash the poo taboo.
But the challenge now is, how do you get really busy into projects that you really love, but at the same time you still might have a major operation, like in a week's time?
Yeah.
So is everything peachy down there? We're going to lift the lid on the signs and symptoms of bowel cancer.
I got a message yesterday, actually, that really lifted me. Somebody saw that campaign, she was 39, and really pushed and said, I've got all these symptoms, I know that there's something wrong with me, and she's just been diagnosed with bowel cancer, but it's been caught early. And she wrote to me to thank me for the campaign because she thinks it saved her life. And I just thought, oh my God, that's incredible. Like, that gives me hope to carry on.
Deborah, I'm delighted you're talking to us. I think it's a privilege that we get to speak to you on your birthday. May I just say, totally frivolously, you look fabulous at 40. Absolutely fabulous. I hope you have the best day.
Oh, thank
and I hope you,
you
get to dance and run around in the rain and have lots of presents and lots of smiles and just enjoy it.
Thank you. It's an age I never thought I'd reach.
When I was first diagnosed, my 40th birthday, it was kind of like this pipe dream. And I've just reached 5 years, which is amazing. However, my cancer hasn't gone away. It's kind of got to the point where it's getting much worse. And as irony would have it, I got hit with something called infectious colitis, which is inflammation of the bowel, which was, in my case, caused by bacteria and septicemia. And I was incredibly, incredibly ill. I was carrying 10 kilograms of extra weight. People thought I was pregnant. In fact, I looked larger than when I actually did have my pregnancies. But as a result, all my chemotherapy had to stop. And that chemo was halting my cancer. And what essentially has happened is the cancer has started growing. So it doesn't feel that hopeful, I have to be honest with you. But things change so much. They change so much. So when somebody says, oh, what are you doing for New Year? I don't know.
I have been off social media for the last week, and I've gone through the most traumatic event of my life. So I picked up my phone and I've decided to start talking about what has happened to me. What is now 5 days ago, I unfortunately started hemorrhaging blood everywhere. And my husband found me with Eloise screaming down the phone, you have to help my mummy. And all I remember is coming down the stairs and shouting to my children, I love you, I love you. I love you forever. And I thought I would never see them again. I started to lose consciousness when we got to the hospital, and I have flashbacks of a crash team kind of putting blood into me as quickly as possible, and a couple of hours later I was deemed stable enough to undergo surgery. I
I remember coming round and saying, I'm so grateful. I thought I would be dead. And I never planned for it to be like that. I thought I would have a day, a moment, a week to say goodbye, not shout it downstairs to my children. Morning. 10 a.m. in the morning, still from my hospital bed. I was really, really hungry at 4 o'clock in the morning for some random reason. They found me some Rice Krispies, which I'm very grateful for. Then I kind of managed to sleep. But unfortunately, every half an hour, I wake up screaming. My fear is that nobody's coming to help me, and every time I close my eyes, I cry. I can't bear to be alone. And in these times where COVID is around as well, it's even harder because the one thing that you need is the one thing you can't have. Your loved ones right by your side. And that is utterly heartbreaking. The plan is today at 3 o'clock, I'm going in for another operation under general anaesthetic to hopefully sort my bile duct. But I feel like I'm in a bit of a fighting mood today, which I suppose is better. I'm going to be brave, I'm going to put my big girl pants on. I'm going to get through this. So I will see you the other side. Hello, I am off my face. Pretty awesome, right? People are awesome. Here, the skill that they can do is just mind-blowing, actually. It's bloody amazing. And I'm sure I will crash at some point, but I'm through the other side. And I'm gonna clock off for the night. Hello, good morning. It is day 8 from Big Brother Hospital. I'm attached to kind of a variety of different drains and I just am feeling, I don't know, I'm having a bad start to the day. I've kind of lost confidence. I forget, like, whether I'll ever be able to walk again in the outside world. I need to find that fighting spirit in me. I've woken up really depleted. Come on, Deborah. Come on, Deborah. You've got this, girl. Hello, happy Sunday. I've kind of been inside this room for a while and I read a few things that lay over and over on my mind. People kind of saying, well, she's stage 4 anyway. I'm surprised they bothered to save her. I mean, reading things like that when you have just come through a trauma is absolutely hideous. I think I'm obviously uber sensitive and forget that 99.999% of the comments are incredible and supportive and lift me up. But it's amazing how fragile I am. It is 4 a.m. in the morning and I've been having a good cry. I don't know how anybody can get through what I'm going through at the moment. I've kind of been crying for 3 days now. I'm starting to lose the will to live. And I never, ever, ever say that, ever. I want to be living, but I want to actually be living. I don't want to be existing. This is the hardest thing that I've ever done in my life. Deep down, I so desperately want a chance to stay alive. Morning. So I've just had a massive shock in a good way and I didn't see it coming at all. So I've just seen my oncologist and he is so happy with my progress that I'm being sent home. But I've already now told all my deathbed confessions to my husband. Will be a very eligible bachelor. Clearly, he's been playing on my mind. I had a list of girls that I was like, right, they're going to pounce on my husband. And so I listed off a couple of names that I said that I would do my damn hardest to come and haunt him if he hooked up with those people, which I thought was absolutely hilarious. I want to have a bench where I live because I don't like the idea of ever being lonely in death. I like the idea of being somewhere where my kids can sit and contemplate and read a poem. Oh, I'm getting emotional now. So all that kind of stuff came out very, very quickly in terms of my wishes. He couldn't take any of this because he was just like, Deborah, I don't even want to think about this. I planned to do this like TikTok when I was leaving, you know, the Celine Dion one. And then I was like, right, I can get my mum to bring in like a sequin gown. Because obviously, you know, I've got a joke about my dying. I can't quite believe it. I'm pretty emotional. I've basically stepped back into a house I never thought I would see again. I feel incredibly grateful. I don't even know where to start in terms of thanking the medical team who saved my life. It's this incredible roller coaster that I'm still riding. And facing life-limiting cancer is one thing. And then realising that your life could end in the next minute is something else utterly different. And I hope that I will see myself kind of just being able to do the things that I love in life again.
I think it's a really stark reminder of don't leave things unsaid on a daily basis. And it's quite amazing how much you wish just for another sunset or another cuddle or whatever it is. You can't leave things till tomorrow because there just might not be a tomorrow.
When we got to 50 days of this year, I'd been in for 35 of them. And unfortunately, at the moment, I'm in every day. Even my husband was like, don't you get a break over the weekend? And I was like, no. But I am, you know, I am in a really, really, really rough phase at the moment. It's hard. My biggest problem right now is I'm back on treatment, which is amazing. However, I now have a really weak body trying to do treatment, and the side effects are flooring me. It's like this vicious, vicious cycle. I need treatment, but the treatment is killing me. Like, literally. And so, unless we can find a way for me to manage the treatment, I can't physically tolerate it. It's just so hideous. Like, that's the problem. A lot of my friends kind of go, enough's enough. I'm not gonna do this anymore. I've always like gone, no way am I ever doing that. But I kind of understand why you would get to that point that you just go, I can't do this anymore.
Okay.
Yes. Thank you. I'm just hooked up to leads and IVs and drugs that make me sick, and then drugs to try to counteract making me sick. And then every hour of the day, I'm just taking medication, of which I forgot to take this one. Every hour of the day, I'm taking medication. And it's just so, yeah, it's actually quite relentless. Oh, I don't like that one. I get so fed up with it. But then it's really hard because it's not really a choice, is there? Well, there is a choice, like let yourself be septic and die or go through the hell. But then every time you go through more hell, you're like, I don't think I can do it anymore.
Last night, she posted on Instagram explaining to her followers that she's now receiving end-of-life care. She wrote, "The message I never wanted to write. We have tried everything, but my body simply isn't playing ball." Within hours of posting that message, she'd already raised thousands more for her Bowelbabe fund, aimed at increasing awareness.
Before I died, the one thing I knew I wanted to do was set up a fund that can continue working on some of the things that gave me life, such as the innovative drug studies, because if it wasn't for some of the drugs that I was put on early, that gave me 2 years of extra life, and I want other people to have those opportunities. And I've literally just found out that in less than 24 hours, it's just gone over £1 million. It makes me feel utterly loved. But it makes me feel like we're all kind of in it at the end together, and we all want to make a difference and say, you know what, screw you, cancer. We can do better for people. And we just need to show who's boss.
It's just been announced that the Queen has approved the honour of a damehood for the cancer campaigner and podcaster Deborah James.
Yay!
On social media, she wrote a simple message, "Damehood conferred," telling the BBC she was blown away.
Less than 24 hours after the Queen announced she would be honoured, Prince William came to her parents' house to present the award in person. Prince William said, "Every now and then, someone captures the heart of the nation with their zest for life and tenacious desire to give back to society. Thank you for giving hope to so many who are living with cancer."
I have a really loving family. They're just incredible. And I know that my kids are going to be surrounded by love. And you always want to know as a mother, are your kids going to be okay? And my kids are going to be fine. But it doesn't mean that I'm not gonna miss every chance that I could have had with them.
I'm not on social media because unfortunately, even talking and stuff like that is just too tiring for me now. Sadly, I just wish that Tesco's had done it last week, because then I could actually like share it properly, have the energy to like put some gumption behind it. But I just can't do anything really now. But it is amazing. I'm just fucking knackered.
She was at the Chelsea Flower Show to see a rose that had been named after her. She launched a range of clothes with a Rebellious Hope T-shirt that has raised money for charity. Deborah published a book. And then, on Father's Day, she posted this image with the words, "My dad is brushing my hair because I have no strength anymore."
Right, so Debs, before we get going, what...
You're very quiet.
I'm very quiet, apparently, Matt. Can you boost me, any? How's that, Debs? Can you hear me?
Just.
Yeah, that's the headphones thing, you see. If you manage to get the headphones, you'd be able to hear me a bit better, I reckon.
Well, I can't walk, so it's more whether it decides to connect or not.
Don't worry, Debs, don't stress about it. As long as you can hear me and I can hear you, that's the main thing. Just before we get going, Debs, what kind of thing, what do you want to say?
I don't really know. I just need to not cry.
All right. Okay. Let's just start talking, right? And let's just see where we go. Okay. So, okay, here we go. All right. Hey, Debs, how you doing?
I could say I'm doing fine, but I'm not. I think the last... week I've processed what I knew was coming in the last 5 years. And I've got to the point that I feel like I've been, you know, playing with the devil. And I think, you know, when you think, oh no, it's caught up with me now. My liver is not working, basically. She says currently now drinking champagne with rosé. I'm getting so weak and my body just can't do it anymore. And I've tried so hard for 5 years. And I'm still trying really hard, but my body just doesn't want to play ball anymore. And that's what's really scary about it. I've gone from somebody who used to run 5K a day to somebody who needs her husband to pick her up. I've decided that I want to be at my parents' because I can see greenery and my whole family can come here, and it's where I've kind of always wanted to die, weirdly.
I know this is a stupid question, Debs, but how are you feeling in your head?
I think partly numbness. I'm amazed at how tired I am. I've had 5 years knowing that this will happen to me, and it's still shocking. I'm currently in a stage of doing death admin, which I remember distinctively Rachel talking about, and just saying, God, when you die, there's a lot of death admin to do. Rachel's always in my mind, actually, even now, how brave she must have been, because I don't feel that brave. I think, well, she can do it, I can do it.
You can.
Maybe she'll meet me on the other side and she'll be like, well, better late than never.
You make sure you give her a hug from me if you do.
I will. Absolutely.
Excuse me. Sorry.
You make us both cry.
I know.
Oh. I suppose that's it from me. I can't believe it. That is it from me. Which is a very sad thing to say, but I'm pleased that I have got to the point where I can say it. And we'll see each other again somewhere, somehow, dancing. And until then, please, please, just enjoy life, because it is so precious. All I want right now is more time and more life. Oh, and also check your poo. Come on. I can't leave on any other word apart from check your poo.